think that's my job. Of course I care about archaeology, but I care about history, I care about sociology, I care about, I've got a friend, an old hippie friend, who I've known since the 60s, who said to me, everything is interesting, because everything is part of this extraordinary adventure we have called human life. But there are incredibly boring ways of talking about everything. And I feel that there was a rather, maybe by accident rather than by design, a rather elitist conspiracy as far as archaeology was concerned up until 20 or 30 years ago. You know, it was a discipline that was so arcane that nobody could spell it. But isn't that ridiculous? You would have thought, you know, if something was really interesting, you wouldn't call it by something that you just had to throw an enormous number of vowels at hours before you had the chance of getting the spelling right. And when you read the majority of archaeology books, with the exception from the 50s onwards, people like Glyn Daniel and to some extent Mortimer Reading, they are there impenetrable. And they talk a kind of coded language, which I think was partly because you want to, you know, if you're an academic, you want to keep that stuff to yourself. But also partly out of insecurity. One of the things that I've learned, not having been to university, but seeing it from the outside, is how terrified an awful lot of academics are about peer disapproval. And if you discover something, but you shroud it in code, then nobody can point the finger and say, oh, it wasn't that. Because you can then say, well, no, it's not actually what I said. I said it was a linear, not it was a line. You know, whatever it is they say, you know. And so I think I've seen my job for an awful long time now as finding things which other people might not feel are interesting and trying to find ways of making them interesting. I did a series which I'm very, very proud of about 4 years ago, which was actually on the British legal system. It was called Crime and Punishment. It was a four-part of the British legal system. And they use that now undergraduates again, which I'm really pleased about. And that was a challenge, you know. How can I, not so much how can I make this interesting, because of course it's interesting, because people got arrested. It's in prison and hung, so of course that's interesting. But how do you make it coherent? So that was the challenge. And again, it just, you know, it's just a circular thing. It just goes back to what all the things that my dad talks to me about and the ways that he tried to make things coherent to me as a five-year-old.
Why has Time Team only got 3 days to find out?
Why has Time Team only got 3 days to find out? Well, it's got a good ring to it, isn't it? You swag when you said that. There are a number of reasons for that. One of them is quite serious. When we started, it was centred around four or five academics, all of whom could get the Saturday and Sunday off because they didn't work there. All of whom could bunk off either Friday or Monday. But any more than that, they might get found out. So 3 days was perfect if we were going to get our academics. Another reason was a financial restraint. We were commissioned by the Continuing Education Department at Channel 4, and education, like education in virtually any other organisation, was the smallest, least well-funded department. So there was a limit to the amount of money that they could give us. And very soon after we started, we had this dilemma. Do we make less programmes in more days, or do we make lots of programmes in only 3 days? And I think that Mick was, from the start, was very keen to say, look, it is only keyhole archaeology. It is only about assessing what's there. And you can do that in 3 days. And it represents an awful lot of the archaeology that's currently being done. And here's what I'm going to say. I never thought I would ever say. This is all thanks to a Conservative minister. It was Michael Heseltine who set up something called PPG-16, that's what it is, which, and that was a kind of a law which said that if any developer put in Tesco's or a motorway or a big building or anything like that, then what they had to do was have an archaeological assessment first. And suddenly that meant there was an enormous amount of work for archaeologists and an enormous lot of short-term work for archaeologists, because obviously all the time they were doing that assessment, there were guys with very fat wallets and big diggers drumming their fingers waiting for them to clear out again. So that was what they wanted to do. And last year, PPG-16 was actually under a great deal of threat. And for one of the first times, I'm pleased to say that organisations like English Heritage and the National Trust, CBA, the Council of British Archaeology, they all managed to get their act together. And they, for the moment, they've headed that off to a large extent. But I do think that's something that needs to be watched, because if the developers get their... if the developmental lobby gets its way, we'll lose that. And if we do that, then we'll lose an awful lot of our heritage.
Which has been the most successful site after we've left?
In a way, there are two questions in there, because the phrase "after we've left" I think is very important. What we do when we finish, we don't just walk away and leave big holes for people to fall into. We have a reinstating unit. So today, still in Braggston, there is a group of four or five people recording all the stuff that we found, recording it by drawing it, recording it with a grid so that you know exactly where in the drawing it comes, recording it with GPS, recording it with photos, host of different ways. And that means that if anyone wants to continue that dig later on, then they can come back and just go down into the archaeology straight away. And obviously they'll be able to use the information that we were able to give them. So when we left, we always reinstate, we always come up with earth. That may sound a bit counterintuitive, but if you think about it, all the finds in there have been protected by earth and protected at that temperature all the time they've been in there. So actually the best way to look after them is not to rip them all up and put them in a glass case in the museum, but to cover them up again for some time in the future, when we'll know much more about archaeology than we currently do. And that's the whole thing about why we don't dig more, because 100 years' time, can you imagine how much people have left? Even since we've been doing time, think of the advances, for instance, in DNA that happened just in that short time. All those bones, which for years people just bundled up and shoved in museums, and they're still there, festering away in museums. And if there is an argument for not digging, here's a valid proposal I'd say. Don't do any more digging until you've actually done a reassessment of all those huge warehouses attached to all those museums across the world. The field archaeologists here are particularly excited about that. But so, what's the most exciting one I've ever done? Well, we've all got different answers to that. I think for me, we once dug a Roman villa, and we were just about, maybe 5-6 inches down, and the Roman floor specialist banged the earth with the upside down bit of his trowel. And I think there's a Roman tessellated floor just below there. I said, "Oh, it's exciting." It's, yeah. And just handed me his trowel and said, "You do it." I said, I can't, I'm not an archaeologist. And he said, "It's all right." He said, "It's a floor. The whole thing about floors, the whole thing about the Romans making floors like that, is that they're tough. You can all make it up. Behind you anyway, so make sure nothing goes wrong." So, well, what if I pull up one of those in those eggs? Well, if it's loose, it might come up. It's got a little fork. It's there for it. It brings it back. So I started to trowel. out the way, and I saw the first blue tesseract, which was a big moment for me, and then more. And then I realized the two colours, black and white. What is it? More, there's a third colour, there's a fourth colour, there's a pattern. And gradually, oh gosh, I mean, there was about half this room's of this room worth being uncovered. And it was all there, except there were three gouges through it. And they'd all been done with deep plough, and only been ploughing deeply in that thing for the past 10 years. But it was still just the highlights of my life. It was on the highlights of my life. You
obviously, there's a huge amount of history on television these days in general. Obviously, the aim is to try and make it as entertaining and accessible as possible. But do you think that there's a place to say in recent years that all fiction should be being looked down at?
It's interesting this phrase, Duncan, isn't it? It's a phrase that people seize on as an example of a television going bad. I'm a big advocate of television. When people say that television isn't like it used to be, or television has dulled down, I ask them what television they really liked from years and years ago. People always say Hangover. Step Trancer. Or Chronicle. I say to them, go and look in the Radio Times for that week and see what was on. And I hope you'll forgive me saying this. They'll find the Chronicle, they'll find the Step Time. It is surrounded by complete shite. The fact is that, you know, television is a popular medium, and there has always been an awful lot of stuff that, by and large, what you might call discerning middle-class audiences won't enjoy, but they seize to themselves strongly those icons and hold them dear on television. It's like, I think if we look back in 20 years' time at the television that's on today, and there's a heck of a lot of it, so like we said, an awful lot of it will actually stand up to television from earlier times. As far as dumbing down is concerned, one of the things that you don't want to do in television is keep the same audience that gets older and you lose the young audience coming in. Not that older audiences shouldn't have television programmes, it's not that at all. It's just that after a while, you find you've got less and less people watching your programme, and once you do, you're in a situation where the television company can't justify the enormous expenditure on your programme. For instance, our programme costs something like £180,000. Each one costs £180,000. A lot of people think that if we did a programme where we didn't find much, we would just kind of bin it and only show you the good ones. We can't, there's no way we can do that. It's not even, you know, not possible to even think about it. But now, time team is going out at 4:30 in the afternoon. Most programmes at 4:30 in the afternoon are made for like £40,000-£60,000. But we at the moment have this luxury of still being extraordinarily well funded. But it's not going to, you can't justify that. No business can justify that forever and ever. So you have to find strategies to try and encourage a new audience. And in fact, last year, one of the things that we had, and I was very instrumental in this. I said, I'm fed up with fronting the programme all on my own. I think I ought to have a co-presenter. Because one of the things that is frustrating is that often I'm not at the most exciting place. Because we've got three units, three cameramen and sound corps. We've got maybe five, six trenches. I'm over here doing all the filming here. Suddenly something exciting happens over there. I can't be there. But if we had two people then we would be able to mix and match. I also felt it was very important that it should be a woman. We also, we all felt that it was important that it should be a young woman because we were getting older. She had to, she's got a degree in some chronology, I can't remember which one. So it's quite legitimate that she should do it. But the fuss that it incurred was just huge. Actually, as an experiment, it didn't work great. But there was never any sense at all that it would be, to use that iniquitous phrase, dumbing down. It was just another experiment to find, you know, another throw of the dice to see what might work well in terms of. We didn't continue with that particular one, but we've got a load of new people in this year, and I think you'd agree, by and large, the experiments this year have been more successful than they were last year. But it's funny, isn't it? I think it's almost as though sometimes people want television not to be as good as it was. They're seized on this idea. You seldom hear people say, God, television's better than it used to be, isn't it? And yet, I don't know if anybody saw Law and Order, a series called Law and Order, it was just on BBC Two recently. Just bloody brilliant, you know, sound certainly as good as Zen Cars and zombies. Having said that, quite often we have been in a situation where an expert will spend 3 days drinking tea. Because, see, the problem is, you think you've got a Georgian site, because all the information leading up to going there is that you've got a Georgian site. You dig it, it's Roman! you know the cameos that we often do? Sometimes they go right out of the window. Remember one that was the other way around. It was all about Romans marching. And there was nothing Roman at all, it was all prehistoric. So we just had to send that specialist away. And all the people were dressed up in their Roman costumes to go. What can you do about it? You can only dig the archaeology that's there. And we don't cheat. If ever, it's only minimal. If ever we do any kind of assessment of that ground beforehand, it'll only by and large be because we're concerned that there might be some services, a big gas pipe or a big oil tank or something like that in the ground, which would prevent us doing the dig. There's no point us going there and then finding the health and safety reasons we can't do the tour. But we always say if we're doing that. Or just occasionally we go to a site and John's already geophysed it for somebody else 3 or 4 years ago and come away and say, well, that's already done. But we're always honest about that. When I'm engaged?
No.
if we are engaged.
Are we engaging
a younger audience? I think the answer is yes, but not enough. And also not enough women. There was a time when it got really bumpy. And in fact, it's still embarrassing at the beginning of the time to you look around to that bonnet and all the people sort of discussing the stuff. It's all blokes. And then you look at the people who are doing running the office, and they're all women. And you begin people are doing the digging, and they're probably about 60% of them.
Yeah.
About 60% of them. And you look at the sort of second layer of specialists, and they're probably about 30% of them. But there has been this invisible glass ceiling. And the reasons for that, I think, are very complex. I think it is partly to do with the fact that if you've got all men on top of an organisation, they tend to think in terms of blokes being the senior echelon. It's like a kind of default. They have to think outside the box before they get a woman in. Or if they do get a woman in, they're getting a woman in and she comes with the inverted commas right. I think it's also something to do with the history of archaeology over the last 20 or 30 years. It has been hard in many aspects of archaeology for women to rise as high as men as quickly. We lose the good women we get, we tend to lose pretty quickly. There have been a number of efforts, I think it's fair to say, to raise the number of women who are actively involved. And yes, it has worked to some extent. It hasn't really hinged right up to the 2020, and that's very frustrating. As far as kids are concerned, every nerdy kid in England knows about 20. YAC, the Young Archaeology Club, has done hugely well a few times, and I'm the president of YAC, and everywhere I go, there's young children who are my people. They come up to me in the street and, you know, I make them kneel. And that's great. But, so, you know, are there very many 11-year-olds in Hackney who go with respect to no. Given that archaeology came very much out about out of, say, you know, the scrutiny of one particular barrow or the scrutiny of one particular villa. It was all about stuff. It was all about that little things. And in about 1959, wrote a book, Making an English Landscape. And he made what seems just like the most bleeding obvious observation there, which is you can't really understand the archaeology of the place unless you start walking around and having a look to see what's beyond it, to see how that landscape works. Once you know how the landscape works, you actually understand the logic of the archaeology. Mick, for instance, says to me that if you go to a village or a small town, don't start looking around the streets. You've got plenty of time to do that. First thing that you want to do is to go up to the top of the church tower. Go up to the top of the church tower, you will see the lanes, and the lanes will go wee 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 wee. That's the old stuff, isn't it? It's going wee 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 because it's avoiding stuff that was there. It's cheaper to put in the strange stuff. It wasn't just the Romans, you know, it's to get from here to there, you only go like that, and then from there. And you'll see if you're very, very lucky, you can see some of the old Norman stuff, you can see when the old Norman new towers were put in, you can see when they're truncated by the medieval stuff, you can see when the Georgians got round to putting their stuff in as well, you can see what the Victorians did, you can see the 1960s developers, God bless them. And the whole thing has a logic, and the little bit of archaeology that you want to see suddenly has a context. Context, context, context. That is the order. And that is what and Mick was enormously influenced by that kind of archaeology. And Mick never wanted to stay with the archaeology. Mick always wanted to wander off. And it wasn't that he was sneaking away. Well, when he was young, he was looking at women. But he was wandering off just to be able to look at it like that. And you know Stuart. Stuart, I absolutely adore. And Stuart, not only does Stuart wander off, Stuart lies on the ground in order just to, you know, to get those little hills. Stuart loves looking at discovering trackways, looking at maps, you know, the logic of a map to see there's a little bit of track there, and then there's nothing for a few fields, and there's a little bit of track there. Oh, it's on the same alignment. Oh, there's something there. Suddenly, you know, bang, 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 thought process is going. You understand the archaeology. So I do think that what you were beginning to talk about, that environmental understanding, is very important. The other thing is little animals and how we cope with them in archaeology. Now that is that we do find that very difficult. The number of sites that we have had to wear slippers and plastic gloves and tiptoe around and dress in newt costumes so we won't frighten the newt. No, we don't bring newt costumes. Do you know what I mean? In order to avoid the newts, we never ever see one.
Oh, one somebody's higher,
fun. Oh, okay. I came from somewhere else. It's a real problem, I think, finding the right rhythm between defending our living environment and defending our archaeological environment. And indeed, in giving space to the future, because I think that one of the things that most of the archaeologists in time seem to hate is that notion that if something's old, it has to be excavated for fence barriers. A stick with a drawing on it in language that nobody understands anyway. And then that's it. Mick said to me once, "Do you know what I would really like us to do? I would like us to find the remains of a Cistercian abbey and turn it into a McDonald's." He said it would drive everybody mad. He said, "But think about it. Think what it would do. Suddenly, it would come back to life. Suddenly something which would be just hanging around there, all wonky and useless and vaguely aesthetic in a Victorian way, would be something that kids would come to, and you know, you could put in the stories in there, you know, tell the story while they're waiting for their burgers, they can see, they would understand what that place used to be. It's gloriously outrageous, and I think it's got an enormously compelling logic to it. That there are very few countries, as well, I'm sure many of you are much better travelled than me, who have identified their past buildings and then kind of locked them in some kind of intellectual aspect in a way that we do. By and large, they've incorporated them much more than that.
You spoke about the dangers of archaeology. I'm just wondering, do you have an opinion on whether the Elgin marbles should return to the Greeks?
I understand why it's a problem for the British Museum. In that, if you are going to, by giving something back that is so iconic, are you going to create a situation where every country in the world wants everything back, and suddenly the whole notion of museums is undermined? Now, it may be in 150 years' time where we will look back on museums as a very antiquated thing. It may be that we'll have other ways of understanding our history rather than going to museums, which after all are only really intellectual funfairs, aren't they? They're Disneyland for people with degrees. I say that as somebody who has goes to the one of the most greatest experiences of my life, but I'm sure that museums will be rethunk. But I can understand why the BM wouldn't want to create a situation whereby they could create a precedent which makes that happen very quickly without being properly considered. Having said that, the Elgin Marbles, I think, are a particularly good example of a very specific piece of rape by Lord Elgin. It's very hard to justify the notion that they should have been taken because otherwise they would have been to pieces. And given how desperately our Greek cousins want them, given that they've even built a room for them and cases for them to go back into, to me, I think we should get it back. Having said that, I don't know.
It's a bit of a dual question, really. Are all the sites you've done acknowledged or known beforehand, or is it the case of somebody saying, I think I've got a bar at the bottom of my garden?
So, could you all hear that? Are all the sites that we did already acknowledged as sites, or are they just sometimes in someone's back garden? When we started, we would have been happy if all 13 of the series had been people's back gardens. That's what we really wanted to do. I think one of my favourite times ever was in Rawls, which where we dug someone's back garden and there was like, and they like koi carp. And they dug a thing to put their koi carp in and they found a skelly. Because they watched Time Team, they brushed it away and got the old toothbrushes out, and they got the local archaeologist in, and it was an Anglo-Saxon, and they got an Anglo-Saxon craving. And that is like the perfect Time Team for us. But they're hard to find, those digs. The digs come to us in a number of ways. Sometimes what we irreverently call punters just write in and say, I've got something and I think it might be something, would you come and have a look at it? We've had two or three researchers all the time. They just keep their antennae open and they offer us sites. Sometimes large organisations like English Heritage, the MOD, National Trust. Oh, is that who we were working for? I gave a really hard time. You racist in the National Trust. Yeah, so sometimes they'll come to us and say, we've got a site, you know, will you help us with this one? Well, I'll tell you about a site we've done recently, which is so cool. Sometimes our own archaeologists will find sites. I've found a couple of sites and most times we've said, should we do those? We've been rather seduced over the last few years by the fact that because the largest organisations want to work with us, they will offer us really sexy sounding sites. But the problem is, by and large, if you're digging, let's say, a stately home or an army camp or in the environment of a cathedral, virtually, almost by definition, they will be places which have been able to employ huge amounts of labour from the medieval period onwards, which means almost always the exciting stuff has gone, completely gone. And yet we still make the mistake, I think, of going back to those places. And we would be much better taking the risk of going to a site which isn't a recognised site, but where we've had a little sniff that something might be really good. As I say, there are a number of different ways. The one I wanted to tell you about, it's an MOD site, it's on Salisbury Plain, and it's a new project for people who've come back from Afghanistan and Iraq, shot up. A lot of these people have got no legs, some of them no arms, one of them terribly distressed just because they've been under fire for so long, explosions have gone on. And the army now has much more of a sense of responsibility towards them than I think the British forces did in the past. And one of the things that they try and do is to get them, a lot of them just don't want to do anything, a lot of them get into deep, deep, deep depression. It's to try and get them doing things they haven't done before. So they run this archaeology course, and it has been a fantastic success. And one of the things, for instance, if you've got a local person who hasn't got any legs in there, there isn't, there are often not that many things he feels that he can do, that he can do to the quality of people who've got all four limbs. But archaeology is great. You know, he just gets down there, he's there for ages and ages and ages, much more upper body strength than most of us have got. He'd be a fantastic archaeologist. Eight of these blokes are now doing extramural archaeology degrees at Leicester University. A huge success it's been. Not that all of them will want to be archaeologists, but actually just going through that process, that all the things that I've described. And a lot of these guys, of course, are squabbies, and a lot of them haven't had any education. So suddenly to realise, really rather like me, that doing something like archaeology, you don't have to have done degrees. You know, it's a tactile thing, it's an emotional thing, it's an understanding thing. And it was a great site, another Anglo-Saxon burial. Really good. What about 40? 40 The furoric, what was my take, given what I was saying about women, what was my take on the furore around Professor Mary Beard, you know, the writer A.A. Gill slags her off. He always calls me A.A. Gill whenever he reviews anything I do, never refers to me by my name, he just calls me Baldrick. well, it's just so, it's so old fashioned. Almost not worth bracing it with too much debate, is it? But I just the notion that you need to look a certain way in order to be able to have a certain skill seems to me so much the antithesis of what most people really actually want. I don't know. I was really, really moved by that opening ceremony. It's not original. My first time I thought this is. But around about the time those big factory chimneys came on, I suddenly started thinking to myself, do you know, there is a sense of Englishness, or my sense of Britishness, that's probably more accurate to say, which actually is very inclusive. And that's not about, by and large, that's not about party politics. And I know, you know that the Daily Mail got it kind of completely wrong. I was sort of slagging off the other. So there was one Tory MP who said, oh, that was just a bunch of lefty nonsense. I just thought that that whole ceremony transcended all those kinds of divisions and offered an image for Britain which was very much about heritage, it was very much about narrative, it was very much about history, it was very affirming as far as people looking different ways is concerned, about different races and genders that were concerned. And you know, I just, given we've had, it's been pretty miserable 4 or 5 years, isn't it? And to see that accepted by so many people, and then to see us these shitloads of medals.